Then since I am planning to use random inputs, I will need a random number generator. So in C language, there is a LRAND 48 and an SRAND 48. These return long integers. So LRAND 48 returns a long integer. So in order to use that, I will have to first apply a seed. This one is, it can be any number. It is an initial value that I put in the flip-flops. Remember how we used to do this random number generator using LFSR? It requires a seed. So I am starting with one. Then, for as many simulations as I require, I had to repeat all this work. So the work that I am repeating is I am generating a random multiplier and I am making sure that the number is no more than this max number. Because you see, what will happen is LRAND 48 gives a very large number and I may want to size it down to n bits. So that is what I am doing here. Same is true for the multiplicand. Then I am writing the debug message here. And then here is another debug message. Okay, I'll show you what the debug is. And then finally, I will call a program called sim. So this is our Booth multiplier. So sim is here. So it is the same algorithm that we have discussed before. I take as input the number of bits, the multiplier, and the multiplicand. And internally, I will declare M, A, Q registers, F register. And I also need a bit MSB to extract the MSB. And then I need this I to iterate over all the, from 0 to n or n minus 1. Initialization requires cumulative to be put to 0, Q to be set to multiplier, M is a multiplicand, and F is equal to 0. And then I repeat, n times. So QF represents the 2-bit number. The 2-bit number will be, the Q percentage 2 gives me the LSB of Q, and F is a 1-bit number. So the total value of that 2-bit number will be 2 times QF2 plus F. Okay, so this is the value, numerical value. Then I will check. There can be only four possibilities: 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. So in the case of 0, 0, and 1, 1, I don't do anything. I just do a right shift, which I'll do here. If it is 1, then I have to do an addition. And I think I have to increment that numAdd. And here I have to increment numSum. If it is anything else, something is wrong, right? I mean, obviously that cannot occur. Then I will extract the LSB of Q and put it into F because I want to do a right shift, right? After that, I am ready to do a right shift of Q. and I have to take the rightmost bit of A and I have to put it in Q. So for that I am using this. Okay. So set bit will take a given number and set the specified bit to the specified value. I have written a procedure called set bit. Set Q of n minus 1 equal to A of 0. See, this absolute is required here because unfortunately what happens is if the accumulator is negative, right? So suppose the accumulator was minus 5, then minus 5 percentage 2 will be minus 1. Okay, so that is why I had to use this absolute. I only want 0 or 1, right? That is the reason I had to write the absolute macro. Then I will also extract the MSB of A. So A is a n bit number. Remember, A in reality A has been declared as an int. So it has 32 bits. But I don't want 32 bits. I only want to simulate n bits. Okay, I mean, I want to treat A as an n bit number. So as a result, I will, do it this way. So this will get me extract then do a right shift and then whatever MSB we had extracted, ensure the sign is all right. Debug is just a print. So when I say debug, it just puts a print. It prints all these values. When I don't want, I can remove it. Once I'm convinced that I am okay. Here at the end, I can print number additions. So let me compile this. Then I can run symboot. Okay. So if I simply run symboot, it will give me this usage error. Okay. The correct way to run it is specify the number of bits and the number of simulations. So let us do only one right now. Okay. So it took a random case. Okay. The numbers it selected were 5 and 4. Okay. And this is the answer I got, which is 20. Okay. And it has done one addition and one subtraction. Okay. In the same way, if I do, let us say 10. Okay. So it has done 13, which is pretty good, right? See, in each case, it could have done as many as perhaps two, okay, two additions and two subtractions. So there could have been as many as 40 additions and 40 subtractions. I'm sorry, 40 additions and subtractions, but it has done only half of it. 21 it has done. Okay. So if you continue. So 82 plus 129 is approximately 200 something. Okay. So we have done 100 simulations, right? If you compare the original algorithm, that is the original shift and add multiplier, then we are saving quite a bit. There we would have done four additions, okay, four in every simulation, so 400. In comparison, we are doing only 200. Okay, so it is looks like about half. Okay, so we'll do 50% savings by using this method, right? So we can try a larger number, 8-bit or something like that. Okay. So again, you will see that the original algorithm, the shift and add multiplier, I would have needed 800 additions in every clock, in every multiplication. Now I am doing approximately 400 or something like that. Okay. So on an average, looks like if all the bits are equally, in each bit position, I've assumed that the bits are, there is a 50% chance of being 0 or 1. Okay, see the numbers it has picked here. They are, if you look at the bits here, each bit can be either 0 or 1. But if I change that, okay, if it is more likely that some of the bits are 0, okay, then I may get better results. Okay. So I will leave that exercise to you, right, to figure out how will this improve if, let us say, I have more zeros in the inputs than ones. Okay. Any doubts here?
I think, sir, one participant says...
Aniruddha has asked a question. Why are we not using data types like uint 8t or uint 16t? We could have used Aniruddha. I don't know. When we do programming, it's everybody has a one way of doing it. If you want to do it that way, I won't stop you. Please feel free. Can we synthesize C code in general? Nandini has asked. There are some research groups who have done this, right? But it commercially, I'm not sure if anybody supports C as a language of synthesis. There is a language called Hardware C. But to my knowledge, there are only three big commercial EDA tools. There is Synopsys, Cadence, and Mentor. To my knowledge, none of them support C, Hardware C. They all support Verilog, VHDL. Okay. So if your question is, why am I doing C language? I could have done this in Verilog also. Okay. But sometimes if our only interest is in finding out whether this algorithm will provide any improvements in power, right? And I'm not really going beyond that, right? So sometimes we can model it at a language like C also. Okay, there is nothing wrong with that. See, remember that, I think many of you are imagining, right? That the person who writes the RTL also does the synthesis, also does the simulation, also does physics. That is not like the way it works. Okay. As a student, right, they may teach, right? You may, in your college, if you do a project, then you will do the behavioral, description. You will do maybe some synthesis. So you may even develop the library cells that you require. You may do physical design, static timing analysis, everything you may be doing, right? But it doesn't work that way in the industry. It's not possible, right? What we do is we have different domains. Okay, there are people who mainly spend time on verification. people who spend time on synthesis. There are people who spend time on design for tests. There are people who will spend time on timing analysis. So they become experts in that particular tool, right? Because they keep doing it all the time. It's better to be like that than have the same person doing everything. Then his expertise with the tool will be limited, right? So as a result, somebody who is an algorithm guy, let us say somebody is a signal processing guy, right? That person is, let us say, trying to build a filter or something like that. They may use MATLAB, they may use C or something like that. They don't care about the synthesis aspect, etc. That somebody else will do. They are developing the algorithms. Is that clear? Any doubts here? So MATLAB is very much used. Okay, but by a small number of people, right? So the question that Nandini is asking, whether it is possible to synthesize C code, the purpose of creating the C code was not necessarily to synthesize it. It was the intention to check whether my proposed Booth's recording of multipliers indeed reduces the number of additions and multiplications on an average. Okay, that was the purpose of that study. And to do that, I can do it in MATLAB, I can do it in C, I can do it in any language that I like, right? And then once I have frozen the algorithm, then maybe I can give that algorithm to somebody and they may take that and rewrite it in Verilog or you can treat that as a spec. The original C code could be even treated as a spec to the guy who did the RTL coding. Okay. Any questions on this? Okay. So please don't underestimate the power of MATLAB and all that. Can I implement MATLAB code on TMS 320? Yes, I believe it is possible. So there are a few target boards you can do that. You can take your C code, right, as well as MATLAB code. So MATLAB code is first translated to C, and that C code is then implemented. See, normally these embedded processes, they only support the C programming. Okay. It is very difficult to support too many languages on that particular hardware. So they typically support C. So MATLAB to C and then C to. Any question? How is Indian VLSI industry beyond verification? They are doing everything, no? It's not just verification. I don't know why you got the feeling that they only do verification. Of course, they are doing all of them. But I told you, right? I mean, the new college graduates, they are not likely to be working on, design to start with. They may be given small modules, right? So they will start by first, see, because you may not even have used various tools, etc. So you need to first, flex your muscles a little bit on the industrial tools, etc. So in the beginning itself, I cannot call you into my office and say, hey, go and design this, right? Because we have to work in, there are timelines, right? And there are deliverables, isn't it? See, when you are doing your small project for internship or college project, at the end, you're only interested in making something work and, it may have a lot of bugs, it may have a lot of scope for improvement, but I think you will declare success if it begins to show some signs of having worked, right? But, if you ask more deeper questions, then a lot of assumptions may have been made, a lot of problems may be there, a lot of loopholes. So that is not acceptable in the industry, right? Because our design will go into the hands of customers and they may break it, right? So we have to have a good design which is strong, robust, it works in all situations. So that is the reason why there are some, and you have to do this in a reasonable time, right? So think of it that way. Okay, I hope that answered your question. Gaurav, is that clear? So Indian industry is doing everything. It is not other than manufacturing, right? Manufacturing is one thing that is not happening here. But other than that, all other aspects of VLSI semiconductor industry are present here. Okay, so we will go back. I think I had promised you that I will tell you the name of the textbook, or rather book. It's not a textbook, it's a book. The name is, the author's name is Chris Spear. So this is a, it is published by Springer. So as far as I know, this is like the, you know, one book available. I'm not aware of too many others which are available, but this is published in the year 2008. Okay, so it was published in 2008. Feel free to take that book. Any questions before we move on? So let me continue, right? So we had discussed all these data types, right? Yesterday we got a chance to use the Q data type, right? And I had talked to you a little bit about the class data type. I hope you can see my slides properly. So I had given you this example of a complex number. Right. Now suppose my interest is in modeling, let us say an LFSR as a class. Okay, so what do you think we should do? That is our exercise. You understood? The exercise is, So in other words, I should be able to create an object whose class is LFSR. So what do you think that object will do if I have, see presently I have data types like string, I have data types like the basic data types, I have queue, etc. But I don't have a built-in data type or a class such as LFSR. So if I create one, what do you think it should be able to do? What are some procedures or methods that I can run on it? Can anybody try answering the question? So here is my LFSR. Okay. Does it make sense to say here is an LFSR? Right. It doesn't make so much sense, right? What else do I need to tell you if I had to say it's an LFSR? I have to at least tell you the number of bits, and I have to tell you the characteristic polynomial. I can say this LFSR has 1 plus x power 3 plus x power 8. So if I say this, then it makes sense. Then I know that it has 8 flip-flops, and we have tapped 3 and 8 as the feedback points. Okay, this makes sense. Then what should this LFSR have? I mean, what are some of the capabilities of the LFSR? One is maybe, you know, we will apply a clock, right? And we'll see what it produces as output. So we'll assume that there is a some sort of a clock mechanism. So every time I apply a clock, similarly, there may be a seeding mechanism. I may be able to load it with some seed. So if I declare I need at least seed. I need set the I need a procedure to set the values of the characteristic polynomial. And then maybe clock. Then maybe get these are the four things that I can think of. Okay. You may be able to do, you know, you may be able to think of more procedures. Any doubts? So let us go back and look at the syntax of class. So it is very straightforward, class and then end class. So we'll copy that down here. So we'll call it as lfsr.sv. create a class called LFS. So the class will be called LFSR. So that's basically what it is. Oh, I think, is my typing visible to everybody? May not be, right? Because I don't know how to share the whole thing.
So you can share the screen. You have shared the screen, I believe.
Just a minute. Share screen, all right. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir. Now it is visible.
Yeah, so I was just copying the syntax from here. Now you can see both the PPT and
window. Yes, sir.
Okay.
GVIM window, sir. Both we can see.
Okay. Fine. So within the LFSR, we will possibly need to keep n bits, right? Where n is, see, since I don't know how much n is, right? Maybe we can try to do what this guy did earlier. You remember when we don't know ahead of time, we can try doing a dynamic array, right? So let us try doing that. So we can create something like this. Why this window goes away? So logic, right? Maybe Q. This is a dynamic allocation. Okay, so that is what I have done, and each element of Q is of type logic. So it can take 0 and 1 as the values. Maybe we can keep the number of flip-flops as an integer. So this is all part and parcel of the class data type. So we'll have the actual bits. We'll also keep the number of flip-flops, right? Then let us try to create some procedures, okay? So maybe one of them can be our set function. So what will be the typical things? I'll provide a set. I may, I also need another one, right? Logic. Let us say I call all that as the characteristic polynomial. So C poly will have a zero if you are not tapping that particular bit. It will have a one if you are tapping it. Okay. So C poly of I is one if we tap bit I. So if somebody wants to set this LFSR, they have to specify many things. They have to specify the C poly. Maybe this is good enough. And the C poly what is the best way of specifying that polynomial? Maybe again as a array. Okay. So maybe we can say logic or let us just to make it a little bit more interesting, let us say like this. So in other words, C poly that is coming in is a vector. Okay. For example, if let us say I want to specify 1 plus x to the power 6, then I know that bit number 6 is being tapped, right? And bit number 1 is being tapped. So let us rewrite our LFSR. This is my flip-flops. Q1, Q2, Qn. This is how my flops are arranged. So if I am tapping Q1 and Q6, then I am tapping this this position and Q6. So if I have to specify this as a vector, right, then it will look something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. and max is defined to be let us say whatever 32 or something. We are allowing up to 32 bits. And if you prefer 1 to max, that is also fine. If you prefer the way I have written, you know, 1 to max, that may be better. So what is it that I need to do? How do I calculate n? I can even specify n directly. Okay, if you don't want to struggle, you can directly write int n. Okay. You can take it as input. Otherwise, you will have to scan that vector and find the position where the one occurs, you know, the last time when you see a 1. So if I don't give you n, it is possible to figure it out. Is that clear? Any doubts? But I'm going to keep it simple. I'm going to assume that the person who does a set will also specify n. It is redundant. There is no need for me to specify. You see, when somebody says 1 plus x power 6, 6 is already being given to me, right? But I am making my life a little bit easier by insisting that 6 must also be specified. So what should I do? When somebody wants me to set the number of flip-flop, you know, should be set equal to n. So nff is my the variable which is part of the class, right? And I am going to copy this n here, and then perhaps I must create an array, this q should be equal to new n. Remember that is how we were doing it earlier. Okay, you are supposed to say new like this. That is the way to allocate storage. Similarly, cpoly will allocate storage. At this point of time, set does not specify what q is, so I'm not going to say anything right now. Whereas C poly has been specified, so I'll copy it. Okay, so maybe I'll declare in int. So I have just copied whatever the characteristic polynomial was. Are you following? Tanmay, what does no mean? Following everybody. So I have declared a set procedure which will allow the initialization of any object that was declared to be of the class LFSR. Similarly, let us create a task called display. This task is only going to, it's like a debug. It will make sure that I know that the everything is all right. So we can say dollar display . So it will declare the number of flip-flops. Then maybe I can display the state. So this is just to ensure that I am doing things correctly. Okay. Then maybe we can have a seed. It should specify the seed. And maybe the seed is also being specified as a logic 1 to max. And what should I do? I should simply copy this to Q. Seeding is over. Now the next thing is clock. I guess clock doesn't really require any inputs. What should I do? I should now simulate the behavior of the LFSR. So I should only look at those bits which are pointed by C poly. Okay. So for example, my Q may be 101101. Poly this may be equal to, see, I am tapping 1, 2 is not tapped, 3 is not tapped, 4 is not tapped, 5 is not tapped, 6 is being tapped. Then what I must do is I must sample these two. So what is the best way? If I do an XOR of Q and C poly, right? Or should it be AND? AND may be better, right? AND, see, if it's a 0, it'll get wiped out. If it's a 1, it'll, yeah, I think AND is better. So take the AND of C poly. It'll have 1000. If this was a 0, this will give me 0. Then I must XOR all these bits. Okay. That is what will enter the LFSR from the left hand side. Is that clear to everybody? Some question has come, Harsha. So this set task is similar to constructor. Yeah, it's like constructor. So we'll have to do the logical AND of the two. But we have declared Q and C poly as dynamic arrays. So I don't know whether there is a direct way to do AND. We have to do it one by one only. So let us declare some int temp or logic temp. And temp equal to new NFF. And for I equal to 0, I less than NFF, I plus plus, temp I. We can also do like this. We can keep a the number of ones in this ANDed array. See, we can count the number of ones in this. Okay, that is another way to calculate the XOR gate, the XOR. Okay, so I can say begin. I think it's okay to say plus equal to. And if the ones count is odd, then I must shift in a 1, otherwise I must shift in a 0. So I can say a bit to be shifted. Okay. So that could be my shift bit. And then we have to first right shift Q. Okay, so we'll do it. I think I have made some mistakes here. It should be one, right? Because I think I declared Q to be from I think the count, the indexing begins at 0, so 0 is okay. It's okay, guys. Just check. Can anybody confirm that this is correct? What I have done? I wanted to do a right shift of Q. Okay, so I start from the rightmost. I think it should be NFF minus one. I think the rightmost will be indexed NFF minus one, and from there I will go all the way up to one. Okay. So in each case, I'm copying the one which is on the left hand side. And when it comes to the zeroth bit, I had to take the shift which I had calculated. Anybody thinks it's there is some problem? So we have written the procedures for setting or initializing or constructing the LFSR. We have written the procedure for clocking the LFSR. We have written the procedure for displaying the contents. Right. So let us go ahead and try this method or class. So maybe we can build a module called test LFSR. So this time I will declare LFSR as a type, because that is what I have called it here. Okay. I'll say LFSR, let us say, 3-bit. The first thing to do is allocate space. Space, because this is not yet allocated. So we will try to say new and then say 3-bit LFSR set. I have to set specify another array which is 1 to max. Okay, so I'll have to specify gave this 101, the rest are all 0. So to do this, I can use hexadecimal. Okay. And I can say A followed by 1, 2, 3, 4. So why did I say A? A because 1010. The first three bits should be 101. The other bits are all 0. This is a characteristic polynomial. Then similarly, let us set the seed, and I think seed I was assuming will also be a like this. So let us assume seed will be it will be 1 followed by zeros, etc. So I only want 1 in the beginning, so I can say 8 so seed is 100. This is the first position, then 0, 0. I will display and then clock. So I'll keep clocking it. So hopefully that will show me all the values. And if I have done everything correctly, it should come, all the values should appear. Let us see whether this will actually work. There is some bug because I'm seeing X, etc. So let us see what the output has been. Initially, N is 3 is correct. So initial state is 1, 0. I think there is some confusion of 0 and 1. Yeah, I think the confusion has come because let us start with see, here is the problem, right? See, I am starting from 0 here, but C poly should not be I, right? It should be I plus 1, because here it says 1 to max. Okay, it's 1 to max, so it should have said I plus 1. See, C poly is a Q. There the indexing will begin with 0, but here it should begin with 1. So that is one mistake. Similar mistakes may exist. Hopefully they are not there. See here also. Unfortunately, it writes this dollar display seems to always write a new line, so I can't see it in a nice way. If anybody knows how to avoid that, tell me. Dollar display, can I avoid writing the new line? So let us see what it has done. So initially this state was 001. Okay, you should read it like this, 001. Then it moved to 101. Okay, because we are tapping, I think these two positions. So one will enter, that's correct. Then 1 and 1 is 0. Really confusing to me as to how this is working. So C poly always remains 101. Is that correct? I think that is correct. So C poly cannot change, and it was 101 is correct because I have tapped these two bits. Okay, so this I'm happy, so I'm going to delete this. So let us see how it's working. So it took the XOR of these two bits, this one and this one, which is one, so that it brought it here, and this one and zero got shifted. And zero and one, it brought it here, and these two shifted. One and one, zero, it shifted these two. Zero and one, it brought it here, zero and one shifted. One and one is zero, and one and zero. Looks like it's all right. Okay. So as you can see, it returned to the original state. It went through all the states, okay, 110, 1111, etc., etc., and it came back to the last state. Okay. Is there any way to avoid this dollar display from printing the new line? Can anybody figure it out? That will help me a lot. Dollar right. Huh? Let us try dollar right. Madhumita is suggesting that I should use dollar right. So let me try that. I don't think I need to debug this anymore. This characteristic polynomial is all right. The only thing I need is this. You are right, Madhumita. Correct answer. Right. Is n equal to 3 also we can avoid. Right. And so this time, instead of a 3-bit LFSR, let us try the one which we saw earlier. See, for 8 bit, it is 4, 5, 6, 8. 4, 5, 6, and 8. Okay. So let us try. This I'm going to remove. See, this pattern will now be different. The pattern will be we want 1 is 0, 2 is, 1 is 0, 2 is 0, 3 is 0, 4 is 1. then 5 is 1, 6 is 1, 7 is 1, 7 is 0, 8 is 1, and so on. So the pattern I should give here is 0001 is 1 and 1101 is D, right? And then rest is 0. The seed, let it remain the same, right? It doesn't matter to me. And then instead of 8, it will be 256. So assuming that my coding is correct, LFSR should go through all the 255 states. So feel free to go and get yourself some coffee or something, because it seems to be taking some time to get. See, we are in a queue waiting for others to release. So I don't know how long it will take. Just take a 5 minutes break and then come back. We have not started running. If you think that it is taking very long to run this system Verilog code, that is not true. We have not even entered the queue yet. We are waiting for the queue. So I think nested comments are not allowed. See, I have put one comment here and another comment here, so it's not going to allow that. Why is n coming as 0? What is wrong? Anybody knows? 8-bit LFSR is set to new, then 8 and I don't understand why n is coming to be zero and all that nonsense. This was the initial state. Why did this? This is a C poly which always remains the same. So let me. Okay. So these are the states. Okay. How many such outputs have come? You can see that there are 256, and this 100 is getting repeated. So I think all the states did get generated. Okay, you can verify. I'll show you. So it started with this one followed by all zero state. Okay, and then. States that are getting generated. All the states have been generated. Okay. And finally, it has recycled back to the one followed by all zero state. Okay. So I think it is working. Okay. We can try larger ones also, but once it works up to 32 bits, it will work. Okay. If you want, we can give it a last try. For 24, but I will do it and show it to you tomorrow. It may take a while for it to simulate, right? Any doubts so far? Any doubts? Please ask. So we have used the class concept today, and that is a learning for you. Okay, we modeled a LFSR as a class. So I can extend this to also model a single input signature register and multiple input signature register and so on and so on. Okay, and then life becomes easier once I have all those MISR, etc. And I can create larger blocks. Any doubts? You have to ask questions. If you want me to demonstrate something again, I will demonstrate. Maybe last part was, if it was not clear, let me know. Okay, if you want, let us do this one more time. 20 bit. Okay, so 17th and 20th bit are 1. Okay, let us do that. This is a 20 bit LFSR. So this time we'll have to. Mistake I made last time was I forgot to put 20 here, right? Then what is the seed? 17th and the 20th bit are 1, right? So let us figure it out. 1 is 0, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Then we have 17 is 1, 18, 19, 20. Then the rest are all 0. So what should be this? This should be 0, 0, 0, 0, 9, then 0, 0, 0. The seed is always the same. It starts with 1. So and this time it should simulate 2 to the power 20, okay, which is I don't know how much is that, 2 to the power 20. I think it will allow this. So it will take possibly a little while to do all the simulations. Okay. So you can see that it came back to the initial state. Okay. So indeed looks like all the states did get generated. Okay. So if I only extract the state bits from the log, then these are the states. If I see how many such, you know, then 1048576 have been generated. Okay, so looks like it's fine. Okay, so 2 to the power 20 is possibly this number. Okay, 104856. Okay, so as long as you understand the encoding and do it correctly, you should get all the states. Any doubts, guys? Now the next thing is, what if we want some constrained random number generation, right? That I think I may have explained on the first day or maybe the third day or something like that. See, if you know how to create I think this we used, this randomized procedure we had used. In the same way, here is an example of what is called as a random object. Okay. So I have created a class called random class. Okay. In that, this is a declaration of an address, okay, memory address, which is a 32-bit address. But I'm also qualifying this as a rand. This rand is a qualifier, right? And I can also put a constraint. Okay, the name of the constraint is 0 to 3. And this is the constraint. So if you put this constraint, then when you do this randomize, it will obey those constraints. It has pretty complex constraints possible. Not only number should be less than, greater than, etc. But I believe you can also specify that it should be sampled from a specific kind of distribution and stuff like that. So let me quickly illustrate this. Okay, one more thing we can try doing is this associative array is there, right? So we can try that also. Sorry, let us put some constraints. See, the constraints were not available, so let me put some constraints. Constraint, it should be in the range 0 to 10. So this time I have put a constraint, so it is generating within the range 0 to 9. And we are using that associative array, right? So we are looking up the names. So the ID 9 got generated several times. So if you generate it, if I generate a very large number of random numbers, then there is a good chance that everybody will get a chance. But right now, some names are getting repeated more often than the other. Okay, so it is not uniformly distributed, looks like, right? So we'll have to try running it many times and see whether everybody gets a chance. Okay. Any doubts? We have only about 5 minutes left. So if there are any questions, I can ask. I can answer. I can try. Any doubts? Okay, there are no doubts. I'll do one thing. I'll send this file to you, to Amit or Vineet, so that you can try it if you have any access to system Verilog, etc., both the LFSR and the I'll send them to Vineet. Okay. All right. I'll see you later then. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.